People who don't get it are making the wrong investments. This is what I meant by dumb money, right? With the dot-com thing, you had to put your money into a company. And so therefore, a company was better than not a company. But you don't have that choice here with Bitcoin. With Bitcoin, you have the choice of investing in a company or investing in the currency, which is basically an ETF on all the companies that are out there, because their success drives adoption, all this other stuff. So it's this feedback system. But the point is that if an idea is bad and you're putting money into it, whether it's Bitcoin or dollars, those are dollars that you're, or Bitcoin that you're not holding as Bitcoin. So if our thesis here is that this continues along, adoption continues to grow because it should, because this is simply a better option than has ever been available, then in theory, you do actually need both sides of that equation.
Absolutely, you need it. But right here in the US, we now have two parallel economies. There's the economy of the Dow Jones Industrial Average that's doing great. There's the economy of the 1% that are doing great. And right underneath that is everybody else who is basically losing their middle class status, and the middle class is dying in the States. So the question is, in the future of Bitcoin in the US, which economy is it supporting? Which economy is it representing? Which community is it representing? Well, and I'm afraid that all of these billions of dollars and VCs and all of these other things, what they're doing is they're pulling the center of gravity of Bitcoin in the United States towards the 1% economy that doesn't care about any of these principles and will quite happily leave the rest of us behind and keep extracting value. They've just found a new goose that lays golden eggs, and they're going to try and co-opt it and capture it and turn it into this watered down, lame copy of PayPal. And the problem is, among other things, that a big part of our development community and some of the most powerful institutions in Bitcoin, like the foundation, are based here. And if they get caught up into that narrative, you know, they could very well drag the rest of the protocol with it. And that's, I think, a risk.
But again, I mean, it's this exact process that you're talking about that is making these determinations. I mean, ultimately, the downside, as you said, is that this stuff doesn't happen in the US. It's not like the Bitcoin Foundation is going to do something that's going to cause the failure of Bitcoin. If they do that, then people are just going to not do it. People are just, the project will be forked. And there will be, here's the Bitcoin Foundation's version, and here's the other version. It's, well, the old version.
Let me give you a very practical example. Right now, there is both an existential threat and a tremendous opportunity to fix one of the core problems within Bitcoin. And that is that the core protocol is not anonymous. It's pseudonymous. There's no encryption. And essentially, it becomes a giant data mining database that, through taint and traffic analysis, can be used to do massive and ubiquitous surveillance of all of the transactions. Now, this is something that we need to fix, and it's something that we need to fix in the core protocol. And we need to fix it faster than they build coin validation, filtering, red listing, and all of those things, which will kill the currency by destroying the core fungibility layer within the system. Now, we can do identity and we can do verification at the payment layer above it, but the core transactional layer, in order to remain a low risk, no counterparty risk, low fee, low overhead system, has to be as fungible and as frictionless as possible. How easy is it going to push through those changes when the core development team is being bombarded by this idea that they have to play nice with the regulators and, you know, save Bitcoin from the money laundering forces and give it legitimacy by essentially playing nice? I want to see those changes pushed through. Those changes are radical. They're going to receive tremendous pushback, especially in the US. And yet we need to resist, and we need to put this stuff in the protocol from the get-go, because we didn't do it with the internet and now we're paying the price. So that kind of important decision is, unfortunately, or de facto, being made here. And it's being made not by the consensus of the miners or the consensus of the users, but simply by the inactivity of the core development team to focus on some of these issues, because they are tangential. They're not tangential in Argentina. They're not tangential in some of these most oppressive regimes. The issue is not, can I buy drugs with Bitcoin and get away with it? The issue is, if I try to use Bitcoin to create dissent and subvert an oppressive government, will they drag me and my family away in the middle of the night? So for them, anonymity, privacy means freedom of association, freedom of expression, and the ability to move forward on these important social issues. And here it's being framed as the exact opposite, as kind of a luxury for those who want to play dirty on Bitcoin, when we know that all of the dirty stuff is happening on the US dollar. So how do you push through those kinds of decisions when we have such centralization in just the basic choices of what goes into the protocol next?
We have voluntary centralization. This is the key thing, is that, yes, we have a development team, but that's the development team that we have now. you can already see this divide happening. We've talked about idealists and entrepreneurs before, and yes, of course, there are hybrids, but they do tend to fall into one of two camps because it is that question. Is it about legitimacy with big air quotes, or is it about anonymity, or rather privacy? Legitimacy or privacy are basically the issues that we're talking about here.
Privacy is a basic human right. It's about freedom of expression. It's about freedom of association. And privacy is what enables creative expression. And if you frame it like that, then establishing those properties within the core protocol is what will take Bitcoin to the next level and make it an even bigger power.
But the developers don't have that perspective. I mean, this is the thing, is that like you're asking them to scratch somebody else's itch. So I totally agree with you. You know, this is a problem, but the way it doesn't seem like berating the development team for interaction is the way to do it. It seems like there's a division that's already happened. New York has become the center for entrepreneurs. That's where this is happening. You know, DC to a lesser extent, but really it's people in New York going up to DC. The other side of the equation is Voorhees, Eric Voorhees has started a pretty major enclave down in Panama, and they're bringing down people. And they're not bringing down people because they're working on regulation. They're bringing down people because they're completely sidestepping the issue. If a guy wanted to, that's the thing. Start a shadow development team, you know, start a development team that does the minority report, you know, and then have so many people involved with that, that you're not the minority report. In fact, you're the most active development team out there and you're doing the right work. So I mean, again, it's a meritocracy, but you gotta step up and do it.
I hope so. But what we've seen is that developments in these areas have already happened. Proposals for a number of different solutions have already happened. And by the way, hat tip to Greg Maxwell for creating the concept behind CoinJoin. And we've had some disagreements in the past and, you know, perhaps some bad blood that I regret. But Greg has done some incredible development in simply core innovation around the cryptographic properties around Bitcoin, from CoinJoin to Type 2 deterministic wallets and some of the greatest innovations that have come out of Bitcoin. But again, there are so many proposals that get sidelined, and they get sidelined because they're not interesting to the core developers. And I think that's a problem because there's so much momentum and network effect that building a separate center of power within the development group is very, very difficult. It's a close-knit community. It's very difficult to introduce new voices. And not because they don't want new voices, but because it takes a long time to ramp up your skills and expertise and understand the community and get involved and contribute and gain respect and credibility and be able to affect change. And so this is already happening, but my worry is that it's too slow. And so by the time we figure out this stuff, the central core protocol of Bitcoin may already be ossified. We're looking at this transition phase right now where we need to reach a state where the core protocol is good enough and then we stop messing with it and move all of the innovation to the layers above. But before we get to that, there are some core functions, especially around fungibility, privacy, anonymity, and fixing some of the early mistakes in Bitcoin that have to be in the core protocol. They have to be in the bottommost layer. So developing on Bitcoin is akin to trying to patch the operating system of a 787 Boeing while in flight. You've got $10 billion riding on it, and if you mess it up, you blow up the whole plane and it crashes the ground, right? It's a very difficult job, and the developers have to be very conservative in what endeavors they pursue and what features they do, because this is a live network and there's no going back if you fuck it up.
Aren't altcoins an experimental ground for that? Try different things in the altcoins and see on the smaller networks and see, and if it works, maybe it'll make it into Bitcoin.
Zero Coin is a good example of this.
Yeah.
Yes. And then Zero Coin is now going to Zero Coin 2 and possibly Zero Coin 3 with some of the things that are happening at Johns Hopkins and some of the new developments around that. And there's three or four other proposals for doing encrypted transactions with encrypted sender, encrypted recipient, and encrypted value, which are very promising. But I simply don't see the context in which these can be part of the core platform and protocol. And I think at the same time, we're in a race. We're in a race against legal and regulatory forces that are trying to impose the kind of radical and ubiquitous lack of transparency from the outside in that will turn Bitcoin into essentially surveillance coin. Right. Well, if it is already, Bitcoin isn't anonymous. It creates the false sense of security of anonymity, which is even more dangerous and insidious than if it was completely attached. If Bitcoin addresses were attached to a social security number right now, I'd feel more comfortable because that's more like the reality of it. And people would think twice about what they're doing and they demand stronger anonymity and protection. But because it gives you this false sense of security, nobody really gets what's going on and isn't demanding it. So I can guarantee you right now, someone's building big data analytics to do taint on every single coin. And they've been doing this for years. and they're watching every transaction. And they want to weaken the basic fungibility and anonymity of the protocol before it gets into mainstream, while we need to strengthen them. This is a race. There is an adversary. Like in any aspect of security, information security, it's the only technology where you have a direct adversarial arms race against an opponent. And so we need to wake up and realize that this is what's going on and take active measures to take positions and take strong positions about where we want the future of Bitcoin to go. And that's why I'm worried about this narrative and the point of view that's coming out of these conferences. Let's play nice with the regulators. Let's self-regulate.
Does it have to be a change in the core protocol to Bitcoin, or are services like CoinJoin or Zerocoin, are those acceptable solutions? Would that be okay?
I don't think so, because there's two issues with those. First of all, CoinJoin is kind of weak fungibility because it allows you to do some basic masking of the inputs and outputs, but you can do a lot of traffic analysis simply by tracking the values. In order for a security infrastructure like this to be effective, what matters is not what the power users do. We saw that with PGP email. It never took off. It was never effective because the power users could use it and everybody else couldn't. What we need is a model much like SSL, where the average user doesn't know they're using it, can't turn it off, doesn't have a choice, and it simply appears as a little green lock. It's baked into the basic use of the user experience. We need essentially strong privacy, anonymity, fungibility, and remixing introduced into every transaction that you make on every wallet for the simple user without even knowing that they're doing it until they haven't seen an address, because it all happens in the background. And then when the user is idle and not doing transactions, the wallet is remixing all of their previous outputs that are in their wallet dynamically to create even more fungibility among the various coins that are circulating on the network. In order to do that, you have to make a decision that this has to be a ubiquitous property of Bitcoin. And unfortunately, that's a centralized decision.
So for the last month, I've been basically saying venture capital is obsolete. And
absolutely,
in 6 months, it's going to be really, really, really obsolete, because everybody who was holding Bitcoin 6 months ago, you know, they've done very well. And a lot of people are holding a lot of Bitcoin, and now they're looking to, you know, to start incubators. I know four people starting incubators right now, and other projects too. Absolutely. But the idea to empower other people is really, really there. This early seed capital thing, it's just not necessary anymore. You might, be talking about larger rounds of funding or whatever. But the point is that I don't understand why the solution to this isn't simply for people who agree with this perspective to finance another development team that can have the right perspective and can deal with this stuff and can do the work essentially for them.
We'll call it anti-VCs or something like
that. Well, it's not anti-VCs. It's like the minority report.
You can call
it
dark wallet.
I mean, yeah, you could call it dark wallet. But again, then you're talking about an application level rather than at the protocol level. So this is the thing, is that I agree with you. This should be done at the protocol level. These things, these changes should be made. But I'm just questioning why all of this falls on the existing development team and why it isn't, Bitcoiners who appreciate that this is something that is necessary, ponying up and bringing on developers who do agree with them.
Yeah. Among other things, because it's dangerous. It's dangerous to take these positions. It's especially dangerous to take these positions if you live in the US, because I can take these positions as speech, but the moment I start putting money behind them, I become a target. So that's one of the issues here, that there's a palpable sense of fear, even in the US, about being a proponent for strong anonymity, freedom of expression, freedom of association. Those are passé notions of, a pre-9/11 world or whatever the hell the latest slogan is. We are going to get to decentralized funding. VCs are absolutely going to be disrupted. We did peer-to-peer payments first. Peer-to-peer lending is not far behind. And then peer-to-peer crowdsourcing. And the trick here is not to just simply leverage the community of the uber-rich Bitcoiners. More importantly, what you need to do is create decentralized structures for doing share ownership and funding of essentially company IPOs on a completely decentralized basis right on the blockchain. And if we can do that, we can engage the entire Bitcoin community to fund the things that they feel are important to it. But at the same time, I'm very cognizant that I am a minority and we are a minority in terms of thinking out several years ahead and seeing where this is going and what steps need to be taken now. The problem is that the narrative is still squarely in the space of Bitcoin is a coin, and Bitcoin is a coin that's cheaper to use and can make a slightly better Visa. Obviously, I'm not interested in that, but the vast majority of the community, that's the narrative that they understand. And then you've got all of the speculative investment behind that. we're not going to be able to shift that narrative fast enough. Maybe we will. This is the kind of show where we have to do that. And as you said, Stephanie, speaking at North American conference is one of the reasons we have to do it, is to shift that narrative. But, you know, make no mistake, this is an arms race. And right now we're 4 years behind. And the problem is that we're ready to hit mass adoption. And the bigger this gets, the harder it is to make changes. You know, we're flying a $10 billion aircraft and trying to patch it in flight. What if it's $100 billion in 3 months? What if it's, you know, $500 billion by the end of next year? How much harder is it going to be to introduce hard fork changes within the Bitcoin protocol? Again, that's what concerns me. We don't have time. There is no walk here. It's only run.
Hi, this is Jason King for Bitcoin 100, and you're listening to Let's Talk Bitcoin. But you know, Bitcoin is not really a talker. It's a doer, just like the best nonprofits and charity organizations. And at Bitcoin100.org, all we do is find hardworking nonprofits and charities and give them $1,000 in Bitcoin. That's all we do. So donate to Bitcoin 100 and let Bitcoin, nonprofits, and charities do what they do best.